What up, meathead? This is Travis. American produce guy. Yeah, this was formerly the Meat Block podcast, and I'm formerly a meathead because now this is the episode where I am announcing my switch to, you know, veganism after doing some soul searching about climate change and what sustainability means and ethics and a bunch of other snowflake stuff. I decided to give up the carnivore lifestyle. So please enjoy this episode of the V-Block Podcast.
Good cutting enhances the quality of
fruit.
Poor cutting results in an inferior piece of
fruit,
regardless of quality.
I've been doing this show for 2 years now. This is the 2 year anniversary of the Meat Block. That was a that was an April Fool's in the beginning there. It's good ribbing. It's good good dad jokes. I don't even know if it counts as a joke. I feel like April Fool's jokes are more just like pranks and where people are like just shitty. Where it's like, that's, you didn't fool me. You were just like a dick to me. Like, I always think about that Simpsons episode, that classic, you know. I'm a 90s kid, so I grew up in the golden age of Simpsons before they, I couldn't even tell you how many seasons there's more seasons I haven't watched than I've watched, but I could recite everything from the first seven, I believe. But yeah, there's the classic April Fool's episode where Bart and Homer going back and forth, and Bart puts the can of beer in a paint shaker, and it's the classic, it's a great episode. I suggest you go back and rewatch those classics, not the new stuff. Back then, they also did like more multi-camera angles, where now it's just like a three camera, and it seems like a lot of the voice actors are just phoning it in, not even trying anymore. That was back in the day of Phil Hartman, before Andy Dick gave his wife cocaine that caused her episode that led in Phil Hartman's death. Anyway, 2 year celebration on the Meat Block since I started this podcast. And the reason I started this podcast, as you've heard nauseating times when I was working my way through this industry, I found that it was, the information that I wanted to obtain, that it was coveted. And then I was listening to podcasts a bunch at work, and people ask me what I listen to at work. I literally get in my car in the morning and listen to a podcast, and then for the 9 hours I'm at work, I'm listening to, cycling through different things, and they're majority all podcasts. And when I get caught up, I listen to, you know, some bands that I used to grow up with. My musical taste is really set in stone from when I was the age of 14. That includes like terrible 90s crap of like, just like stuff that I used to make fun of at the time, but now like I know all the words to. But yeah, so I listened to a bunch of podcasts, and I was talking to this guy I was working with about how we should start one. And I said, he wanted to do a podcast network, and that was very ambitious. And that was back before I realized like how much work went into it. That was back when you thought the only podcasts that there were out there were the successful ones, that if you just started a podcast, you'd be successful. Not the case. Then I was like, all right, I started watching YouTube tutorials on how to podcast, and then spent all this money on gear. And it sat around for like 4 months and didn't do anything with it. And it was just like so overwhelming. And like I had this, I couldn't even figure out, like I had this old Dale laptop at the time. And I couldn't even get the free program Audacity to work. And I would be obsessed with noise floor and how everything sounded. And now, as you can hear, there's a dog just casually walking through the studio. because I realized a lot of that stuff doesn't matter in real audio files, and real people probably aren't listening to this podcast for the quality. Certainly, I don't want to give you guys bad sounding audio, but you guys are here more for the stories and the how-to. So we discuss this guy who I used to work with, how we would do a butcher podcast. And I was like, okay. And I was friends with David at the time. I invited him at that point to be a part of the show. And we got together once, whereas the original three of us, and tried to figure out how to use equipment. Couldn't figure out anything. We recorded. I hit the record button, my digital recorder, and it was awkward as fuck. We didn't get any usable content down. We, like, it wasn't just like you press play and talk with your bros. It was forced. It was uncomfortable. And I started doing research about, like, man, just having a casual conversation or doing like an interview style. These are all the techniques and all these things. Started watching tons of YouTube videos on how to podcast. Started really paying attention to the podcast I was listening to at my work. I was like, all right, we should do it where each week we get together and discuss. You look up a cut or you look up a sausage and we tell the other person, the other two about it. Like a dollop episode or like a My Favorite Murder, where like one person has all the information and is telling it to two people who have no idea. And that was proven to be so difficult. Not because the research was difficult, because the getting together and recording was difficult. Of getting three people together, that third person dropped off. And then it was just me and David. And this was all before our first episode, before we had an RSS feed, and David moved in the middle of this point to Michigan. And the dollop style, the storytelling style, the reactionary show didn't really go. So like our first few episodes were a format that we did where we would record together about a topic. And it was so labor intensive, where I would try and organize, and like Harrison's a little baby at this point. And my studio was, you know, in the middle of our stairwell, and David was farming and slaughtering and running a shop. So with a 3-hour time difference, so it was just a nightmare to coordinate at the same time. But in that window of together, I think we produced some of our best episodes. And they're real short. So just in the celebration of the 2-year anniversary at the Meat Block and many years to come, I just wanted to play two of my favorite episodes from that time frame. And hopefully it's a format we could get back to now that David's on my coast and Harrison's growing up, allow me more freedom and things like that. But enjoy this look back at the tri-tip followed by hot dog.
The tri-tip is a cut of beef that comes from the bottom sirloin. It is typically between 1.5 to 2.5 pounds. There's only 2 per carcass. David, what? How do you pronounce the scientific name for it? I'm going to embarrass myself if I try.
Well, I didn't take Latin in high school, but it looks to be M. tensor fasciae latae. Inserted in the fascia lata.
Yeah, so it's a little triangular muscle, and it hasn't always been that popular. For a long time, it's been used for ground beef, and yeah, so we're going to talk about it today.
Good cutting enhances the quality of good meat. In his way, the meat cutter is an artist. Poor cutting results in an inferior piece of meat, regardless of quality.
Remember that guy we used to work with that had that wild game processing place up in Washington.
Yes, Mr. Todd.
The guy that let his dogs eat out of the grime barrels in his shop. He certainly ground the tri-tip. There's no doubt about that. He didn't consider it to be a steak. But I do. I think it's great. And just a little more about it for those of us that aren't familiar. To get more technical, I guess, it's also called the quadriceps extensor. Part of a group of four muscles that essentially are part of the kneecap of the animal.
I call that the knuckle.
Yeah, the knuckle. I used to work with a guy from the East Coast that called it the KFR.
And the tri-tip's lost, usually on the East Coast, or when I worked on the East Coast, we would do a square cut to drop the loin, and call those drop loins.
Yeah.
And if you want to save the tri-tip, you do what's called a diamond cut.
Okay.
And that's more of an angled cut that, and that will keep it on the drop loin.
Oh.
Or I've seen people cut the knuckle off with the tri-tip still on it.
Sure.
I have cut tri-tips off and then kept it attached to the sirloin flap in the past.
That's what I like to do, is leave it as part of the flank.
Most of the time right now, I just take it off as a separate muscle.
Yeah. Okay. That's interesting. So you do an angular cut with a breaking saw, whatever it may be. And so you'd basically end up getting a bit of a chunk of the knuckle as well when you were doing that drop loin.
Well, you would use knife work until you got
okay.
to the bone.
I see. Okay. Okay. That makes sense.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Kind of like how you would take it off with the sirloin flap.
Yep.
But then I just got a comment from our friend in Ireland on Instagram saying new episode tomorrow. I hope so.
I think so. I think we will. Anyways, some more about the tri-tip. So in Europe, it's usually sliced into steaks, from what I understand. In France, it's called the aguillette baronne, and its left whole is a roast. In northern Germany, it's called the Burgermeisterstück, or Pastorenstück.
Very romantic.
In Austria, it's the Hufeschwanz, and in southern Germany, it's called the same name, and it's pretty popular in Bavaria, probably as a schnitzel cut. And it's served boiled with horseradish, which strangely sounds good, I think. In Spain, it's grilled whole, and they call it the Rabillo de Cadera. In Central America, it's also grilled in its entirety. And I think that's kind of how we probably would cook it, or, you know, grilled as a whole and then sliced medium rare. Down there, it's known as the Punta de Salomo. In South America, it's also grilled as part of the Argentine asado, known as the Colita de Cuadril. In Chile, it's a popular roast called the Punta de Picana. In Mexico, it's known as the Picanha. And in Brazil, it's common for the traditional Brazilian churrasco, and it's known as Maminha. In contrast to the picanha, which, you know, we're familiar with as being the top sirloin cap, or the culotte, or the petite sirloin, you know, whatever.
I used to always call the culotte the East Coast tri-tip.
Oh, that's interesting. Okay.
Yeah.
Well, they're both, I mean, those are probably two of my very favorite steaks, so.
And cooking techniques can be very similar.
Sure. Yeah, I guess that makes sense.
And they both have that beautiful fat cap, too.
Yeah, I guess if you took the entire culotte off and grilled that as a whole and served it medium rare, it'd be really similar to cooking tri-tip.
Yeah.
It's a great idea.
But we'll talk about the culotte.
Of course we will.
It's going to have its own episode. And I can't wait to get feedback from all of our friends around the world on how you did on those local pronunciations.
Yeah. Oh, man. Don't judge me too much.
So in the U.S., the tri-tip definition in the MAMP, which is the North America's Meat Buyer's Guide, is a 185D. In New York City, That's a large city in the east coast of America, for those of you who don't know. The Florence Meat Market has popularized the tri-tip by cutting it into steaks and calling it the Newport Steak.
As it turns out, the tri-tip has a pretty rich history in California, where Travis is from, and I visited once.
Santa Barbara, whoop whoop.
And I went to In-N-Out Burger.
If you go to California, your first thing you should do when you get there is go to In-N-Out Burger. And last thing you should do is go to In-N-Out Burger.
Yeah, I think that's kind of how I did it.
And let me tell you, when my family comes and visit, In-N-Out is still okay after a 2.5 hour plane ride.
I believe it. Anyway, so Donna Fong, a competition barbecue pitmaster, claims that her father worked with the man who discovered and marketed the tri-tip in Oakland, California. She says in the United States, this cut was typically used for ground beef, as you mentioned, or sliced into steaks until the early 1950s, when Otto Schaefer Sr. first barbecued it whole on the Schaefer Ranch. He introduced it to the market in Oakland, California. And ranchers visiting the Schaefer Ranch from Santa Maria enjoyed it and took home the idea, where it was popularized by the Santa Maria Elks Club.
I call shenanigans on all of that. Being from California's Central Coast, the Gold Coast, Santa Barbara County, I truly believe that the tri-tip was popularized in Santa Maria and that we're not thieves. Historical records by the Santa Maria Elks Club has a first-hand account of the cut becoming popularized at a local Safeway. They used to just take it and cut it and put it into grind. Then the manager of the Safeway, Bob Schultz, said, "Do you know what? Let's put that on a rotisserie. Put it on there for 45 minutes, and the result is somewhat of what we call Santa Maria-style tri-tip today, with salt, pepper, and garlic salt.
Okay.
That's all you need. So Santa Maria style barbecue is typically either top block, or as we know, top sirloin, with the culotte still attached, cut into two chunks and put on big skewers and slowly roasted over a pitted fire.
Okay.
Because of the high winds in Santa Maria.
Oh.
The tri-tip is seasoned the same way, but put on a grid, still in a pitted fire, with an open flame, so there's no conductivity like you would have in a barbecue or your grill.
Mm-hmm.
And when I was growing up, if you went to a barbecue or a cookout in the summertime and there wasn't a tri-tip on the grill, then you know, they messed up.
Really?
It wasn't a... Yeah. Every place had it.
Okay, so this is like a major... Like a major theme in, you know, Central Californian cuisine is grilled tri-tip. No kidding.
And when I moved to Santa Barbara when I started high school from the Bay Area and never heard of it until I had a tri-tip torta, which blew my mind.
No kidding.
Yeah.
I used to kind of moonlight on a competitive barbecue team up in Washington with a fellow. His team was Wibs and Fixins. And a couple of the places we went, that was it. They had kind of foregone brisket and taken the tri-tip and made that their official barbecue.
If you're interested in how to cook it, I prepared a clip for you.
The Santa Maria-style barbecue has its roots back in the 19th century. The technique was pretty simple. A hole dug in the ground, meat skewered on poles, and a red oak fire. In 1931, the Santa Maria Club started a monthly stag barbecue which became famous across the state. Every step of the barbecue process was handled by a team. The team would first load up the barbecue pit with red oak wood and then prepare the aged beef with a dry rub mixture of salt, pepper, and garlic salt. The seasoned beef was skewered onto flat steel rods and cooked over the oak wood for about an hour. This job was not for lightweights. One rod filled with meat could weigh up to 50 pounds. Soon, barbecue teams formed all over town. Their enthusiasm was as much a part of the barbecue as the meat they prepared. Entertainers like Danny Kaye, politicians like Ronald Reagan, and even Lady Bird Johnson experienced Santa Maria-style barbecue. The meat of choice was top lock, until the barbecue masters discovered tri-tip, the triangular chunk of meat trimmed off the tip of top lock sirloin. The key to tri-tip is the high quality of the well-aged meat. The method of cooking only over red oak coals native to Santa Maria, and the simple seasoning of salt, pepper, and garlic salt. Recently, Sunset Magazine called Santa Maria-style barbecue the best barbecue in the world. But these guys already knew that. They mastered the art of simplicity in barbecuing, and in turn, created world-class barbecue.
I don't expect everyone out there to have a barbecue where you run metal skewers through the meat. So I would just take a regular barbecue, preferably one that can take charcoal. And if you get your hands on some red oak, that's great. If you can't, it's fine. You're going to have the barbecue open. You're going to wait for those coals to get nice and hot. You're going to place the meat on fat side up 15 minutes. Flip it 15 minutes. Flip it again 15 minutes for a total of 45 minutes. Then take off. That's going to allow medium and then the thicker part to be medium rare. Let it rest, of course, before you slice into that thing. And starting with the fat side up is going to keep it nice and moist. That's very important.
It's fairly windy there. You're getting a really high heat sear, good smoke. What are you serving this with in Central California?
You do pinto beans.
Okay.
A nice salsa, like a pico de gallo, and then some strawberries, because Santa Maria's number one export is beautiful strawberries.
No kidding.
Yeah, so, and you'd want that, that would be your dessert. And then you would also, with the meal, serve it with garlic bread.
Okay.
Which it sounds like a mix of cultures.
Sure.
But I like to think that's what, yeah, California is.
Would you grill the bread?
Absolutely, you would.
Like that grilled bread.
So that was our tri-tip episode. Hope we're getting better at this. If you haven't already, please subscribe, please review, and please leave a comment. It really helps us. And you could contact us. Email is themeatblockpodcast@gmail.com, Twitter @themeatblockpod, and Instagram themeatblock. You could contact me on Instagram @AmericanButcher and David @AFarmButcher, and our emails and contact will all be in the show notes. Our intro clip is from a Union Pacific video called Ring the Bell, and it's all about the meat industry in 1946. I hope in the future to upload the audio in its entirety. It's real interesting, and it actually listens real well. When you're listening to it, just imagine hills of beef and slaughter and large-scale processing post-World War II. Last week's outro music was by The Outlaws, sung by Jesse Culture, the song Why You Been Gone So Long. Our first episode outro music was by John Denver, Thank God I'm a Country Boy. And our promo was from Hank Williams, Kalijah. Just wanted to say that, people have been asking me. And we appreciate all feedback, so please email us, hit us up on Instagram or Twitter, ask us questions, and hopefully we know the answers, and if we don't, we'll do the due diligence to find out for you. Also, the song playing in the background you're hearing right now is, of course, Dwight Yoakam and Buck Owens, Streets of Bakersfield. I thought it was a good song to mash up the Spanish culture and the country culture, which I believe is California, just like the tri-tip is. So thanks for listening and look forward to your feedback, and stay tuned next week, and please tell a friend. And remember, keep your knives sharp and always live in the margin.
Yeah, and I think always live in the margin. Keep your knives sharp, live in the margin. Hope you enjoyed how awkward and how bad David's audio sound, and really not much as I think after 2 years of this, I would learn how to talk, but obviously my stutter hasn't gone anywhere and only comes out when I get nervous. Yep, my dad also has a nervous stutter, and he has an anecdote about one time he got pulled over by the police and they thought he was drunk, because that's what happens when you're nervous. You end up... Yeah. Also, being dyslexic, my big fear is being pulled over and then being like, recite the ABCs backwards. And I don't know a percentage of people who could do that when they're sober, or people often be like, you know, spell the city you're in. And it's like, what? I don't know. So those are just unique fears I have. As we move on to my one-time, all-time favorite episode. Oh, the tri-tip episode. That was back when the show was wholesome. This is when the first time we really divulge into the vulgarity. And this is hot dogs. Just in time for Memorial Day weekend, we're going to be talking about hot dogs in this episode. David and I do use obvious innuendo and double entendre humor. So if you're not into that, then maybe skip this episode. But if not, remember. Parental discretion's advised. The world's longest hot dog ever created was 60 meters. That's about 197 feet with a bun that was about 198 feet. It's always weird to see the bun a little bit smaller or a little bit bigger.
The dog shorter than the bun? No yeah. way, dude.
That means you get two shitty bites.
But at that length, it's actually like 2,000 shitty bites.
Yeah. And that was created in Japan. You know, that was the Guinness Book of World Records. I don't know if that's still in publication right now. I don't remember seeing that in the Guinness Book of World Records. I just remember seeing the two fat twins on the mopeds or whatever. Yeah. Then the Guinness Book of World Records like revamped in the early 2000s and just pretty much became a picture book.
Yeah, they really went for it with the pictures and the sparkly fronts and all that stuff.
Yeah. Did you ever watch the TV show Guinness Book of World Records or whatever?
I think I did. Man, I must have been in, Christ, what was that, like 2000 or something?
Yeah, that show was fucking terrible.
Like, yeah, it was really dumb.
Well, it's like records that no one even cared about. It's like, yes, you are the best at that because no one else does that.
Yeah, but I feel like that was Friday night. Before, like after Family Matters or something, like, you know, Step by Step or something, and Friday night was like the one night that my family was going to get together because my mom was going to order pizza.
Yeah, and you were too young to go out and do cool shit.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, part of TGIF.
Yep, eating pizza during TGIF was the cool shit.
Yeah, back when Urkel had a time machine. I don't like Urkel because I feel he's a micro. Digression in today's society where he just pretty much sexually harasses Laura and doesn't accept being in the friend zone.
yeah micro digression.
Yeah, that I think that would not fly. That like dude, you're kind of putting out some pretty strong rapey vibes.
Yeah, he was pretty microaggressive.
Anyway, today we're talking about hot dogs.
Enhances the quality of good meat. In his way, the meat cutter is an artist. Poor cutting results in an inferior piece of meat, regardless of quality.
All right. David, you go.
Well, that big hot dog that Travis was talking about was prepared by the Shizuoka meat producers for the All Japan Bread Association, which baked the bun and coordinated the event, including the official measurement for the world record. The hot dog and the bun were the center of a media event, which in celebration, it was in celebration of the association's 50th anniversary in 2006 at the Akasaka Prince Hotel in Tokyo, Japan. A hot dog prepared by Chef Joe Calderon in Manhattan sold for $69 during the National Hot Dog Day in 2010, making it the most expensive hot dog sold at that point. Of course, it was topped with truffle oil and foie gras and all that shit. No surprise that it was that expensive.
Yeah. Got that truffle. Do you know that term?
I do. claims about hot dog invention are actually pretty difficult to assess, as you know, stories assert the creation of the sausage, the placing of the sausage on bread or a bun as a finger food, the popularization of the existing dish, or the application of the name hot dog to the sausage and bun combination. It's all in question, you know, and then you get into like having ketchup and mustard and relish, and if you're from Seattle, cream cheese, you know, this and that. It's all kind of up for grabs, and there's a lot of speculation there. So we're going to kind of try to get to the bottom of it here.
Yeah. And we won't, because because everyone claims it. One thing we've learned in the few episodes we've done is that I don't think someone sits down and has a eureka where it's like, I invented this, where it's like, you know, people have been eating these things for a very long time. We discovered this in the tri-tip, that its history is a little bit weird, but also people were eating it in different parts of the country or different parts of the world years before we were eating it in America. Regardless.
But if it's sausage, can we just go out there and say it's German?
Yeah. But people have been eating meat in cased form since the time of the Odyssey.
Which is why I don't understand why sausage is not part of communion. You know, I think if the Catholic Church like really got behind having, you know, maybe just a bit of a liverwurst on the wafer.
I was going to say, I think that the Catholic Church got in trouble for making children eat sausage when they didn't want to.
Oh!
Boom.
Episode over.
If you're still with us.
If you're still with us.
Oh, you set me up. I saw that coming from a long ways away. The term hot dog, you know, a lot of people think that it came from, they used to think German sausage makers were using dog meat in the early part of the 1800s. A lot of people think that the term came from using the word Dotson, and hot dog was describing these hot sausages that look like Dotson, so they would call them hot little dogs, you know?
Okay, I that makes sense, I suppose. I know one claim of inventing the hot dog is by Harry Stevens, an American sports concessionaire whose vendor sold German sausages on rolls to spectators at the old New York polo grounds during the winter. He called them Dachshund sandwiches. But a New York Post cartoonist at the time said, you know, he couldn't spell Dachshund, so when he drew the cartoon, he just called them hot dogs.
Yeah, and the reason it happened during the wintertime is people used to buy ice cream at baseball games back then. And who wants to eat ice cream when it's already cold outside? So this vendor, looking for a way to increase revenue, went to a local butcher shop, bought all the German sausages he could, and that's where the hot dog was introduced to the American public as a result of just someone trying to make a buck. Another claim is a street vendor noticed his competition was selling sandwiches because the bread was allowing people to take their meal and go and eat on the run. Mm-hmm. and he was selling sausages, and who wants to just eat a loose sausage in your hand? feels weird. So he decided to put it on rolls, and that's how another tale of how the hot dog came around. I believe it's a combination of all these things, and all these things happened around the same time. And probably someone did see someone doing it, and then regardless, people just said, hey, I invented that.
I think you dug up something that has to do with potentially the origin here that doesn't actually involve hot dog. The word Frankfurter comes from Frankfurt, Germany, which I think probably could have guessed, where pork sausages are similar to hot dogs, highly emulsified, smooth texture, oftentimes pork and veal. These sausages, Frankfurter Wurstchen, were known since the 13th century and given to the people on the event of imperial coronations, starting with the coronation of Maximilian II, Holy Roman Emperor as king. So this guy becomes the Holy Roman King Emperor and has hot dogs as his coronation or induction meal.
Yeah, those Romans just love sausage parties. So.
They sure do, yeah. Vienna refers to, the word Wiener, as we know it, refers to Vienna, Austria, because the German name for Vienna is Vienne.
Yeah.
And that's kind of home to the sausage made of a mixture of pork and beef. Johann George Lanner, an 18th or 19th century butcher from the Franconian city of Coburg, is said to have brought the Frankfurter Wurstchen to Vienna, where he added beef to the mixture and simply called it a Frankfurter. Nowadays, in German-speaking countries, except Austria, hot dog sausages are called Wiener or Wiener Würstchen, which means little sausage, in differentiation to the original pork-only mixture from Frankfurt. And in Swiss German, it's called Wienerli, while in Austria, the terms of Frankfurter or Frankfurter Würstchen are used. So, but I think we're looking at Germany.
Yeah. Did you ever used to have the Vienna sausage in a can?
My mom would actually send that with me in my lunch when I was in elementary school, and I will tell you that that was an item that you couldn't trade shit for.
Yeah. Cup of noodles were big at my that was the top.
Really?
Yeah, we had the trade table, and it was more like you put your thing on the table and then someone could come up and, you know, put something else.
No kidding.
Yeah. But so my dad used to, I'm a Lashky kid, product of divorce. My dad would not make me open a can of Vienna sausage, drain out that liquid, and then put that on a plate with some peas, and then, you know, put a little squirt of ketchup on the plate. And I thought we were living, you know, grapes of wrath, because when that ketchup would get low, my dad would add a little bit of water to it. And I think it'd then shake it up and then squirt that so I'd get this ketchup water, till eventually it was just more water than ketchup.
Yeah. Interestingly enough, that was an embarrassing meal when we were kids, but that sounds really great to me right now.
Yeah. I ate much worse shit in my early 20s.
Oh, yeah.
When I was just poor. Like, I'll just make a big pot of rice and just add different shit to it every day of the week. Back then, my spirit animal was Dr. Roxo. So around 1870, that's when the hot dog came to Coney Island from German immigrants.
I would, just to back you up for a second, I would love to know if any of our listeners out there have any idea how Coney dogs got from Coney Island in 1870 to Detroit and got chili and raw onions and mustard and liquid cheese added to it, or shredded cheese, depending. So just as kind of an extracurricular assignment, if anybody can come up with that, we'd love to hear.
David, what are some common ingredients found in hot dogs?
Well, when I've made them in the past, it's been, you know, trim and fat. Your spices, salt, garlic, paprika, nutmeg, white pepper, allspice, what have you. And then your cure, which is typically sodium nitrate or sodium erythorbate, but I haven't used that one. I've only used, you know, pink with it. So, yeah. Pork and beef are generally the traditional meats and hot dogs. I've seen them with veal, but I think that's probably like gnarly Bob veal or something. Less expensive dogs are often made from chicken or turkey using low cost, mechanically separated poultry. And I would love for you to tell me about mechanically separated, but first, you know, if you could tell me a little bit about your, trim to fat ratio, because if I remember correctly, it's a little bit higher than your average sausage trim to fat.
You're going to want the fat content to be about 40%. And then you're also going to use about 10% ice and then mix with lean. And then your ingredients that, you know, are big staples is you're going to use mustard, and you're going to use dairy or non-fat dry milk to help with binding. Yeah, so you're going to have your get your meat block titchler line, and then you're going to put that in a, you know, a bowl chopper, which in the early part of the last century, that's when machinery became popular to make what we refer to as the modern dog. It's a blade system, and it chops and chops until it starts breaking down the meat to a paste, where it, the water molecules in the ice are is going to bind with the fat molecules to make it creamy, and there won't be any separation. And that's where you get your batter. I'm going to bring it up to a temperature of 60 degrees. That's going to allow air to get out of it, so you don't end up with airy dogs. And then when I stuff it, it's going to go into a natural casing or a collagen casing, which could be removed after the smoking process. And then at that point, they're going to be what we call in the industry bareback dogs, because they have
raw dogs.
Raw dogs, because they have no casing. And I'm going to smoke those higher than you would think, about 160 internal temperature, to get a to get that good snap. And then you're going to rinse it almost like you shock it to avoid getting a wrinkly dog, which you see a lot of in small retail establishments that make their own dogs in house because they don't have a nice automated smoker that could do these steps.
Okay.
And then we're talking about what is mechanically separated meat, poultry.
Yeah, please. I would love to know what that is.
Mechanically separated is, you could do it with all meat, but hot dogs, they usually do it with poultry. And these are big plants that are doing tens of thousands of pounds a day. And they essentially buy poultry scrap. Still has bits of bone. It could be carcass backs. It could be still skinned. You know, they're wholesome. There's no guts in them. There's no feathers. They're a processed bird, but it's a byproduct of the industry.
For cents on the pound, I'm sure.
Yeah. Fractions of cents on the pound. To give you an idea that there's a place locally that processes 1,000 birds a day or more. I don't know their exact numbers, but they ship those slaughtered carcasses that are gutted over to China freight. They get them, thaw them out, bone them out, then ship them back to America. So you for.
And it's cheaper. It's cheaper for them to pay you or I, or it's more expensive for them to pay you or I minimum wage to process these birds than it is to put them on a fucking ship, ship them across the Pacific Ocean. Mm-hmm. Have some people over there process them and then ship them back. It's cheaper to pay that.
And yeah, but these places are the kind of places with the suicide nets, I'm sure. But
I'm sure.
I don't want to speculate. I've been to China.
That's a different episode.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Anyway, and then that meat's able to be brought back here and sold for, you know, 99 cents a pound. But we're not talking about that and the world trade economy and this integrated machine. We're not economists, so we got pretty far off topic. But anyway, so mechanically separated, you take these trimmings, you take these bones with a little bit of meat in them, you mix it with ammonia, which is something you typically don't want to eat. And it goes into a centrifuge and it separates the meat proteins from the bones and from the skin. And then you're ending up with this pure protein paste, and the ammonia evaporates. So it, at that point, when it evaporates, it's a processing aid, not an ingredient. It's very, you know, part of my job is figuring out things like this, how you could use dry ice to help with your processing, and it's just a processing aid. How you could use lactic acid on the whole muscle, and it's a processing aid, but as soon as you introduce it into grind, it's an ingredient. And then that paste is used in hot dogs, your cheaper hot dogs, your hot dogs that contain chicken and turkey, and not just your pure pork and beef dogs.
Yeah, the stuff from Trader Joe's.
Yeah. You know, I still eat them. I believe they're wholesome.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah.
Delicious.
Just the term hot dog by itself mean in America generally means a single loose hot dog or a hot dog in a bun. So like hot dog on a stick is not a hot dog on a bun on a stick. It's, you know, it's just, it could be both.
So hot dogs are commonly served with one or more ingredients, as most of us know. In 2005, the U.S.-based National Hot Dog and Sausage Council, part of the American Meat Institute, found mustard to be the most popular ingredient, preferred by 32% of respondents. 23% favored ketchup, 17% favored chili con carne, 9% preferred pickle relish, and 7% preferred onions. The other toppings that are common are sauerkraut, mayonnaise, lettuce, tomato, cheese, and chili peppers. Condiment preferences vary across the U.S. Southerners showed the strongest preference for chili, while Midwesterners showed the greatest affinity for ketchup. Now, being originally from the general thumb area of Michigan, which includes Detroit, we're real passionate about our Coney dogs over here, and that's a beanless beef chili. It's a little bit sweet, tomato-based. You got a shredded or liquid cheese. I prefer liquid if anybody really cares. Raw onions and yellow mustard.
Is that like a hot dog now, four ways like you get in Cincinnati?
I don't know about that one. I think the Cincinnati dog probably has the Skyline chili on it, which is very similar to Coney chili. Between you and I, but people from Cincinnati and people in Detroit would probably burn a cross on my front yard for saying that they were similar.
Yeah.
If I'm honest.
They're both delicious.
Yeah. That being said, you can also, you can't get Lafayette Detroit chili in a can. You can get Skyline chili in a can. So step it up, Detroit.
Yeah. I used to eat that, Skyline chili three ways, which is on spaghetti. Yeah. My stepdad is from Cincinnati, so that's how it is.
Oh, no kidding. Well, we have a CSA member here at the farm, and she's from Cincinnati, and her parents come back and forth very often, and they bring me cans of the Skyline chili, and that's something that I enjoy very often at the slaughterhouse for lunch. Now, I know where you live currently and where I used to live, cream cheese is a big ingredient, which is complete and total blasphemy and sacrilege to people around here. But, you know, 3 o'clock in the morning outside the cha-cha in Seattle, that's pretty goddamn good.
Yeah. When I was growing up in LA, we'd get street dogs. We're straight up from someone who didn't have a vending license, who's someone who wasn't supposed to be there.
Really? Yeah,
and they were wrapped in bacon and they were served with grilled onions and on a bun, and you'd be walking out of the bar and you'd see one of these carts, and it was just heaven sent, the perfect greasy food to soak up that alcohol.
Perfect.
Yeah. I just,
that sounds awesome.
Yeah, it's delicious. Preferably what I like to put on my dog is everything. I put so much shit on it that I eat it with a fork, essentially. That yeah, like I could eat 3 hot dogs at once, put cheese on the bottom, and put ketchup, mustard, relish, mayonnaise, whatever, then essentially cover it so I can't see it anymore in chili. And that cheese on the bottom's gonna melt, and then I'm gonna eat that, and that's served with a side of antacids and yeah, a 7-Up. And
there it is.
And that's delicious. And that's how I also eat my corn dogs. It's something that I'm judged very harsh on.
Fuck it.
By friends and family. But I don't care.
No way.
Yeah. I view,
you know, down in the South, they put coleslaw on those things.
Yeah. And I do that too. Like a coleslaw slider. Maybe put a hot dog with some coleslaw and some barbecue sauce on it. I also think that maple syrup and sriracha is a great combination. So,
really?
Yeah. Try it with a breakfast sausage.
Yeah, I will. I might just try that in my mouth after we get done with this.
Yeah. The Chicago dog. I know it's blasphemy to put certain things on there. And David, you're from that area.
Well, yeah, I spent half of my life living in Chicago, and people will, they'll come after you with pitchforks and torches if you say you're going to put ketchup on your dog, which I get. I mean, it's, you know, just from a culinary standpoint, the Chicago dog is 100 times better with a fresh tomato slice on it than with ketchup. I completely understand and I support it. It's an excellent, excellent hot dog. Celery salt, sport peppers, mustard, fresh tomato, fresh dill pickle, raw onion, poppy seed bun, and Hebrew National Duck? Son of a bitch. What is it? Here in Michigan, it's Kogel's. You eat Kogel's in Michigan.
Okay.
But, you know, I mean, I'm not a huge ketchup guy, but sometimes that's just what you want to have.
Yeah.
That's okay.
I like sweet tomato sugar paste.
Yeah, me too. Not on a Chicago dog. So nobody come burn the farm down, please. But on other hot dogs, I enjoy them.
Yeah. I hate going to those places where it's like, you see the sign, like, don't even ask about ketchup unless you're a little kid or something stupid.
Yeah, which makes me want to bring, you know, my own just giant squeeze bottle of ketchup.
Well, my baby works in a hot dog stand. I'm making them hot dogs as fast as you can.
All right, that's the show. Hope you enjoyed it. Just want to real quick thank Smoke Duck Hunter 91, Ham Hand, that dude, Abeeds, I guess, Nathan, and Acura 14, and Nostro Damas. For leaving comments on iTunes. And if you want to hear your name, leave a comment. That would be awesome. And I could mispronounce it. As well as Gather and Break and Matt on Instagram and anyone else on Instagram who has tagged us in the past. Hashtag the meat block. Or tag us at the meat block. Help us out. Tell a friend. And that's really the best way to support us at this point. Also, please tell a friend if you think you know someone who may be interested. Like, review, comment on iTunes. We're also available on Google Play and Stitcher. You can find us on Instagram at The Meat Block. And then we're on Twitter at The Meat Block Pod. And you can email us, TheMeatBlockPodcast@gmail.com. You can find me on Instagram at American Butcher. And you can find David at A Farm Butcher. And all this information will be in the show notes. Clips in this show include NWA, Ring the Bell, the Mickey Mouse Clubhouse, and Metalocalypse. And this closing song is Buck Owens, who is making his second appearance on this show, if you're keeping track at home. And the song is obviously called Hot Dogs. And that was a look back on 2 years, and those were two of my favorite episodes. I hope you enjoyed. People ask me why I don't do the music at the end of the show anymore. Maybe not. Maybe no one's asked me about that. But the reason is, one, I wouldn't mind if someone picked up the show, and then I wouldn't have to go back and re-edit out all of the copyrighted music that I used. If this were to start turning a profit, I was looking into that, but since I'm not using it for that sense, I could, it may fall under fair use, especially since there's no money in it. But if there is, then I'd have to go back and change all that. And that sounds unpleasant. Also, it was just a lot of hard work, or not hard work. I kind of just ran through all the songs that I wanted, and I felt myself spending more time looking for music than I did actually recording. So two years in the meat block, what does that mean? I've met a lot of people doing the show, and it's weird. In the beginning, I was like, is anybody listening? Is there anybody out there? And there are people listening. And there's a community. And it's great. It's a community that I hope, you know, lifts you up, you know, and makes you proud of being in this industry. And that they're... Yeah, my whole thing is, if you have questions, just ask. And I'm never one to be like, oh, dude, that's dumb. Da, 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 da. The only time I'm going to get that is if people get like the smell of their own shit too much and they think they're the best and all that. That's really where any form of criticism comes out on my end. But I would never put anyone down. And I think that I want this to be a community. I want this to continue. I look forward to the next 100 episodes, 200 episodes, next 4 years, 3 years, 2 years, 5 years, 20 years. But for me to want to continue doing this, I want to make sure that there is an audience. So just let us know. Say, hey, I enjoy the podcast, because I thrive on that. And, you know, 2 years ago when I started this, like, I know what our listeners are. It's pretty impressive. No, it's moderate and steady. But just the people I've met, the interviews and meeting people and talking to people that were just figures. You know, before this, I didn't know, you know, Darren O'Rourke. I didn't know, I didn't even know Ryan O'Hearn. I didn't know Brian Mayer. I, you know, envied back when it was the Tri Nations Butcher Challenge, and now it's the World Butchers Challenge, and being envious of the American team, and I got to interview them, and fuck, now I'm on the American team. And I'm sorry about just bragging about that, but like, that's awesome. And that wouldn't have been possible if it wasn't for this amazing podcast I came up with. No, but the podcast itself wouldn't even be anything if no one was listening. Because I know this stuff. And yes, a large part of it is a look what I could do. But it's you, the listener, and I hope you're getting stuff out of it. I hope, you know, that hour a week when we produce an episode, that we make your commute, your opening, your shop, or just something a little bit better and easy. So, you know, when you're in the weeds and you got shitty customers or you got orders to push out, that there's people out there who have done it and are here for you and rooting for you to succeed, and that it will always be here to express grievances and answer your questions to the best of our ability. I'll answer any question, regardless if I know the answer or not. So, you want to support the show? Please tell more people about it. Please leave a 5-star review. Please, please leave a comment. We don't have ads, so it's just 100% driven by you guys and our want to do it. So please help us grow the show to get a bigger audience so I could get that validation. And David could get that validation. And then another way to support just the craft is join the Butcher's Guild. People ask me, how could I try out for, you know, the 2022 team, well, the first step is be a member of the guild. Get out there and network. You know, no cuts and no, just, I don't know, be involved in the community. And if you want to help out the American team, please check out our GoFundMe. Please go buy one of these amazing hats that has been glued on my head ever since I got one. And until next time and all the times after that, please keep your knife sharp and live at the margin. Thanks so much for 2 years. Here's for 1,000 more. Meat Block, Travis Doxill, out.